Pine marten are the stereotypical weasel species in that they're inquisitive, they're quick, effective predators.
They have a strange gait. They can contort their bodies in all sorts of directions. They're beautiful animals, super pretty colors. They have incredible throat patches.
They are just such crafty, feisty little species. They have a lot of personality. They growl at you, they get in your face. They're angry little noodles.
They're full of spit and vinegar, and they are just tenacious little buggers. Pretty interesting little guys to work with, for sure.
Colorado Parks and Wildlife designates 17 specific species as fur bearer species. This would include pine marten. We want to use science as our primary tool to inform management.
When you look at studies that have been done in Colorado, there aren't really very many studies of pine marten in this state.
To manage any wildlife species in a perfect world, a manager would want to know how many animals of that species are out there. In the case of some fur bearer species, like pine marten, it's very difficult to know how many exactly are out there. This project goes into improving the science that we're using and making sure that our harvest regulations are compatible with sustainable populations into the future.
A few years ago, we did some work looking at the impacts of all the bark beetle epidemics. Pine marten were part of the suite of mammalian species that we sampled. I was looking through the beetle kill occupancy data set that we already had, realizing that we had a really nice and rich data set on pine marten. And so we had basically for free a very nice, you know, pine marten occupancy model for the entire state. If we had some estimates of density to pair with that occupancy model, then we could potentially get to an estimate of abundance for the entire state. And so that's what we set out to try to do. We chose to go with a traditional mark recapture approach. And the way that you do that is you have to be able to capture individuals and mark them and then recapture them. From that, get estimates of detection probability. And you can use that to correct the total number that you observe that you know are there and try to estimate the number that were there that you didn't observe and get then a total estimate of abundance. The problem is you get an estimate of abundance, you don't know what area your abundance applies to. So there's some nifty ways of using spatial information to get at estimates of density.
Stakeholder groups that interact with the resource, like fur harvesters, hunters and trappers, are the folks that are very interested in having sustainable populations for the long term. The Trappers Association was quite helpful in providing baits and train our capture staff.
Science-driven wildlife management is done through a cooperative, collaborative process. The relationship between Colorado Trappers and Predator Hunters Association with Colorado Parks and Wildlife, it's a relationship that's professional, it's collaborative. We're very happy to be able to work with the field staff working on the pine marten studies to help support and provide tools and knowledge and experience and time and materials to help set them up for success.
When we get to an area to set a trap, we look at the habitat types, try to place it near a waterway and down logs. We dig it out to make sure it's level, and then we'll cut boughs to place on top of the covey and on the sides to kind of break up the profile, make it look a little more natural. Then we'll put some bait in there. We'll put a scent lure inside the back of the trap.
I use a long distance call lure. That's what will get him within close proximity. Take that long distance call lure. I always put it above the trap, probably a foot, foot and a half. It's going to track stuff for 100 yards or more. Martin comes through here. He sees this tunnel here. He smells the call lure. He smells the lure on the inside, and he's immediately attracted to investigate.
This morning we just set out all the traps, and right now we're baiting all of them. And then in the morning, we'll check on the traps and hopefully we'll get some marten in there.
It's exciting, certainly, when you're catching stuff, especially if you get multiple captures per day.
We check our traps twice a day every day, and we have about 90 traps out, so we don't catch 90 pine martens every day.
Trapping can get monotonous. You're going to the same places, the same traps, over and over and over again, and lots of days you don't get anything.
Open, open. Open.
If we do catch a marten, you immediately kind of go into that mode of this animal's well-being is now in our care, we've got a job to do, and then we'll back away and start to get our capture gear ready. We just get everything set up, and we've got some really cool stuff that the vets and Jake and the biologists came up with.
The initial discussions we had with our veterinary group were, okay, so if we catch a marten in a trap, how are we going to anesthetize it? Because we need to be able to handle that thing. So we had to figure out a way to get marten from the trap into some kind of a chamber so that we could apply gas.
Based on research that we did of people doing past studies on marten, we decided that using a gas anesthetic technique would be the best for these marten. It's very fast, it's safe. The big challenge was to figure out how to get the animals from the traps to a place where they could be safely anesthetized.
Ready?
We built a funnel that fits perfectly on that trap, and that funnel actually goes straight to a tube, which is actually what they naturally want to do anyway.
Where it's going.
Then the gas is administered into a plastic tube.
We put a pillowcase over the tube to keep the animal calm while it's being anesthetized. Normally around 2 to 3 minutes in the tube, the animal is asleep, it's limp, it's safe to take out. So we just pop it out of the tube, lay it down, and then we put a mask over its face.
We have to be innovative with all these different sized animals. The mask is made out of a plastic water bottle with a gasket that's made out of a latex glove.
We normally shoot for a full capture procedure under 15 minutes. We give it that tag. It has a unique number on it, so if we do recapture the animal, we can identify the animal. We collect age, sex, we do weight, body measurements. They all have these beautiful orange throat patches, and everyone is a unique identifier to that animal, so we get to take a picture.
Beautiful.
If for some reason they did lose their tag, we have a database of photos that we can compare that animal to.
We could put the marks on them we needed, take the measurements we needed, and do some exams that we needed. And then the minute you take them off the gas, they recover pretty quickly and they're on their way. We are going to get some density estimates for marten in Colorado, which will be the first we've ever had. So that's a huge step forward. You kind of have to know how many you have and how many you're taking out. Now I think we're going to have a better idea of how many we have. We have responsibility for a huge number of species. The approach we used here is scientifically sound, it's defensible, it's a cost-effective means of gathering better data for managing a whole host of species that we would like to have better information for. Feels good to have done something that is going to be applied and used and will benefit our agency and benefit the species.